Cudkowicz, who's going to talk to us about biomarkers. So please have a seat and we'll get started.
Well, good to see all of you guys close to lunch. To keep it super exciting to talk about how, especially in early phase trials, how helpful so today I'm going to define biomarkers, give some examples, and then really hone in on how these can really help you develop your treatment and get to an effective treatment better. If you spend a fair amount of time really thinking deeply about the types of biomarkers that work with the particular study that you're trying to design. So first question is, what is biomarker? This is a definition that was developed a long time ago by a working group on it, but it's a characteristic that is objectively measured and evaluated as an indicator of normal biological processes, pathogenic processes, or pharmacological responses to therapeutic intervention. So that's very broad, and that is one of the key things about a biomarker. There isn't really just one type, there's actually several types of biomarkers, and they can help you with different objectives as you develop the treatment. And so those are what we're going to go through. So one of the lessons all trialists learn as you do trial and maybe they fail and they think about what you should have done differently is that biomarkers can really help you early on minimize the chance that you have what I would call a failed trial. And a failed trial, I think of, is one that when you're done, you haven't actually learned something. You know, whether or not it has an effect on efficacy, if you haven't been able to rule out that pathway or ensure that you actually got the drug to the right place, then you really haven't been able to afford. And biomarkers can help minimize those types of failures and more positive things that can really help you move forward to the best drug, the best dose, and the right group of people. So some of the things that biomarkers are used for are one, to identify can it hit the molecular target you're trying to go after? I'll give you some examples of that. If it does hit that target, is it actually doing the biology that you want it to? For example, for HIV, if you want your drug to lower viral load can be the biomarker. Are you getting the right dose? Like if you have a biomarker that you can tell the drug is doing its effect, you can test different doses and you might be able to say this dose is too high, this one's too low. So those are just some of the things that biomarkers can help you with. There's a couple of different categories, and there might be more, but these are kind of the six major ones. And we'll go through some examples of each one. Because often these are done in this kind of order, those are played over. You can design studies that have biomarkers that do more than one goal. The first one is really key. Is knowing that your drug gets to its target. And this can be hard, and often your pharmaceutical companies spend a lot of time in this space, with animal studies, to make sure that they know that their drug is going to their target. So for CNS diseases, often this involves PET receptor studies. For example, if you're trying to do a gene therapy trial, knowing that your gene therapy hits and a lot of that work starts out in animals that gets put over to people. And they can be very small studies, just a couple of people, but they're really critical as a very early step. Another type of biomarker are pharmacokinetics. And this is also something that can be done at a single center or two centers, and it's something that early in this career people. And this is really just to know that your drug is how it's metabolized, where it's going, how it's distributed. And again, this is often done first in animals and then brought to people. And when I was a fellow, one of the first studies I actually did was a pharmacokinetic study of the drug that had SOD1. But these can be in 15, 20 patients, but they're really critical because you don't want to go too much farther in your drug development if you don't understand the pharmacokinetics of Another type of biomarker called pharmacodynamic, and these are really also important biomarkers, and this is really telling if your drug has its desired biological effect. These can sometimes be hard to develop, especially for CNS disorders. So again, I'll give some examples of it, but in MS, if you get an inflammatory drug that works on the immune system, a pharmacodynamic marker would be something either in the blood that shows that you have actually affected that marker. Often you can do more than one early phase study that looks at these different parameters. But before you go into your later phase studies, you really want to be sure that you understand both the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic effects of your drug. The fourth category is what I call diagnosis and stratification. So here is that maybe your therapy that you're thinking about only makes sense in some patients. So perhaps it's a drug that works out a part of the immune system, but not all of it. And maybe your patients only a subset of them have that particular type of illness. Then you would use this biomarker to kind of stratify or to pick the right patient for that right dose. And we're seeing that more and more now in neurological trials, where I think it's in any of the fields, stroke and Alzheimer's and ALS, where there's been a lot of big trials that were successful, didn't have a positive effects on survival or outcome. People have gone back to think maybe there were subsets of people that this would have worked better at. Can we develop some tools, whether in their blood or imaging or other types of approaches, to stratify people better and target people better for the treatment? Another set that I think you heard a lot about already from Dr. Schechter are the biomarkers of measuring the disease outcome. Here, in fact, the functional rating scale is the initial study. And lastly, the biomarkers of safety. For example, there are some drugs that have side effects only in people who carry certain genetic mutations or have certain P450 features. So you can develop biomarkers to look at safety. Again, they can be blood-based, they can be so these are used really throughout the development of a trial, but often, again, early on, doing that lead optimization with the target identification. Your early phase studies, you're doing pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic markers. And then really later, as you're in kind of phase two or three, you start developing or using markers of stratification or outcome measures, of course, you're safe. So I'm just going to give you a couple examples of each type of markers, and then we'll have lots of time for questions. So this is a study that we did a long time ago. It was an NINDS-CTMC-supported study to look at subtraxone and ALS. And even though that was a drug that was on the market already for different indication, we didn't know everything about it that we needed to know in order to bring it forward for a CNS disorder. And so the study was actually designed to look at pharmacokinetic data first. So particularly this drug, we knew the pharmacokinetics in healthy people, and we knew it's blood, but we didn't know it was with ALS, and we didn't know it was CNS. So in the first 66 patients in this adaptive design study, we actually did a pharmacokinetic biomarker study. And first we wanted to see if the pharmacokinetics in blood were similar to people with ALS, and in fact they were on one. And then we wanted to see if blood levels predict CSF levels, and also if there were any accumulation of time. And so we get to show that we could actually use blood to get CSF levels, and we could also see that we could get enough into the CSF to match what we saw in the animal models of the dose of the concentration we needed to get in order to have the biological effect. So this was kind of an embedded pharmacokinetic study in a much larger study. And it doesn't answer everything you need to know, but it did answer that we could get the levels of the drugs into the CNS, and we could actually what the half-life was to work on dosing. What we still didn't know was the pharmacodynamic effects as well as the safety and the other parts of the drug development. That's just one example of how you can incorporate pharmacokinetics in your studies. And you don't need a lot of patients for that. You do need a good pharmacokinetic system to help you with the modeling and how to set up the study for that particular study, we used the green light of Tufts, and it was very helpful. So that was the first type of biomarker. The second one, I want to just give some examples about, are these pharmacodynamic markers. And so I think here is where, well, if you are probably going to be in this area, and certainly in neuroscience, you see a lot of the proposals coming in that are in this early phase to space and that are proposing different pharmacodynamic markers. And so these can really be very different. And one of the key things is that you really often have to work this out in the animal models. If it's on you, it's your collaborators, either industry or the lab, to see what you can measure in different whether it's tissue or blood or imaging, to see your effect. So this could be enzymes, it could be imaging, and often this is combined with PK in your early studies. So I'm going to give you two examples of pharmacodynamic markers. One that's fluid-based and one that's imaging-based. And these are both inactive studies. And I know you're getting a lot of examples from ALS because two of you are ALS people, so it's not our goal to turn all of you into ALS people, not anything. So there's a lot of excitement in the ALS world of developing targeted treatments for people with the genetic forms of ALS. And so in particular, the first genetic form of it, the SOD1 ALS, there's now both antisense oligonucleotide approaches to shut off the gene, as well as AAV-directed gene therapy approaches. One of the key things in this illness is that even though we know the genetic mutation, there's lots of different, there's a some 20 years. We need some way to know that the drug is actually having its effect. Its effect would be to lower SOD1 levels. So we knew in the animal models that if you gave this antisense oligo, it prolonged survival, and also that model you could lower SOD1 levels in the brain as well as in spinal fluid. So then the question was, will that translate to people? So this is first the rat study that shows that the SOD1 levels in brain and CSF are correlated, so that's helpful. We don't have the ability to brain biopsies in our patients, so we want to know whether lowering and measuring the CSF will tell us anything about what's happening in the brain in the salt of the animals. And then also, that your oligo actually reduces SOD1. So this is all work done by Tim Miller at WashU. And then, okay, so you can do it in an animal, not what can we do in people? And what we'll also know at the time, measure SOD1 levels in people with spinal fluid and how does that change over time. So before going into patients, Dr. Miller did this study of measuring SOD1 levels in about 15 people or so with SOD1 ALS and showing that it was actually stable over time and reproducible. So this is a good pharmacodynamic marker for the antisense treatments as well as gene therapy treatments. So all that work has got done before, and now there's an active trial led by Biogen, Miller, and others. It's a phase 1 SAD and MAD study, but in the study they've incorporated in this pharmacodynamic marker of CSF SOD1 levels. And there is a go-no-go decision here, both based on obviously safety, but also on whether it reduces SOD1, this pharmacodynamic marker or not. If it doesn't, then in this particular oligo would go forward. So this is, I think, a pretty good example of how a PD marker early on in your drug development can really have been critical for your decision making. This study, in addition, also uses pharmacokinetic biomarkers as well to look at the half-life of the oligo. So in a way, this has incorporated a couple different biomarker approaches, PK, PD, safety, and then we'll also look at some complementary stuff. But the goal is really first for the safety, PK, and PD. So other types of PD markers in neurology often involve imaging, and this is just one example. There's many out there, in the fields that you guys work in, stroke, Alzheimer's, MS, etc. But this one particular example in ALS. So this is a PET ligand that binds activated microglia called PDR28, and it is abnormal people with ALS, and it's an increased signal around the motor cortex. And it seems pretty stable over time. And now this is being used in two clinical trials with drugs that work in neuroinflammation slightly different ways that aren't the 60 Google Labs. These are small single center studies, 20 patients getting a PET scan, getting the drug, and then 6 months or a time period afterwards, see if you have an effect on that activation. And so you know, I don't know the answers to that. These are studies led by Dr. Tassie and his group of change. But it's just another example of how early on, before you do a large, couple hundred patients or a year study, you want to make sure that your drug is having the biological effect that you're interested in before you go forward. And so for these two drugs, if it doesn't have an effect on this marker, that they won't go forward about moving into the phase 2 trial. Doesn't mean they might abandon the drug. They might look at other things like glucosine or other types of markers in the condition. But it would certainly put a halt to going to a large phase 3 trial. And those studies, just to get a sense of cost, are not outrageously expensive. Anytime you add imaging, it's a little bit of cost, but those studies are on the order of $200,000. And again, 20 patients, single center, is something that anyone from the junior investigator fellow or even a more senior person can do. They're very, very feasible studies. And it's really important. So that was the second example of the biomarkers in PK, PD. Now I'm going to give some examples of how you can use biomarkers to help with narrowing perhaps the group of people in your study who have the desired biology that your drug is targeting. And this has pros and cons. The pros are that it should hopefully increase your chance of success of your drug. The cons are that it might end up limiting the applicability of your drug to a broader population. It might be that you have to do studies to see if it also works in other patients. Maybe you can make it very narrow. But the thought is that a lot of studies might fail because you're including a lot of people with different biologies in your study. It can get a little more narrow early on in your studies that will improve success. So this is an example from Dr. Wagner, who's a neurologist, who studied in people with ALS their motor neurons derived from their skin, so induced stem cells. And he found that those motor neurons were hyperexcitable. You could get down to exactly how they were hyperexcitable potassium rectifier occurred, and then found a drug that can reverse that advantage called motility. And so from that preclinical work, designed a clinical trial to pick people with ALS who have evidence of hyperexcitability and measured by traditional magnetic stimulation. And so he's in the middle of this trial. He's also taking people's blood and skin cells to make their motor neurons to see if eventually that might actually be another way to screen people who respond to drugs, but that's a little time consuming. So for this study, they're not using that as an inclusion criteria. So the pros of this is that it narrows the group of people that have hyperexcitability, which is the target of the drug here. The cons are that it does slow down enrollment because you have to do this outcome measure, and at least in this study so far, about half the participants don't have that measure, so it means you have to screen them. But if in the end result, you get a more targeted group and more chance of these drugs to have effect on the right people, then it's worth those kind of constraints. So this is not one study that will have results in about a year. The other similar example that's ongoing now in the ALS world is with a drug called NINDS-CTMC. And I just want to give this story a little bit. So this is a drug that was developed from some investigators in San Francisco. It's thought to work on the macrophages, so to deactivate macrophages. And they did an initial study, a small study, 35 people per group, based on safety. And they didn't at that time have any really biomarkers of the drug hit. But they saw this signal that maybe there was a small subset of the patients who had what they call a response, meaning no progression over 6 months. Now, the p-value isn't significant, but there was a trend. And so what they did is, some people would just kind of throw this out because it's a negative trial. But what they did instead is they tried to see, could they figure out who these responders were? Maybe there's a hint here that there's some patients that responded to the drug, and most people who didn't. And so with a fair amount of work, they did find that the people who seemed to be the responders were the ones who had a higher level in their blood of C-reactive protein. And so this is just showing that in the people with the higher CRP levels, they were able to see the separation between the groups and the dose. So what they've now done is completed enrollment, and we don't have the results of the trial yet, but of a new study of this where they actually screen people first for C-reactive protein and only enroll people who have the high levels and then define the cutoff. And then, the same thing as in the ticketing study, this does slow down their enrollment, but the hope is that it's enriching their population for a group that has the desired target, in their especially younger blood. So this study is fully enrolled and will read out also in early 2018. So this is, happening throughout the terminology. We're getting more focused on trying to make sure they have the population that has the biology that they're targeting. And I think the verdict's still out in neurology about how helpful this is going to be, but I think there's certainly data amongst other fields that this is could be very effective, particularly come from the college world. So in the last couple of minutes, and I know you heard a lot about neurons, but we live and breathe neuronics, so we can't talk about that. I just wanted to give some examples from the first two studies, and I think you heard maybe from about that, but the third and fourth one, so I hope I'm not duplicating anything. I just want to give two examples of studies that use biomarkers, I think, very effectively. And the neuronics is a network that is geared towards a biomarker-driven early-phase studies. So it's really a requirement of the network to have studies like this. So the first study, I just wanted to tell you about, is by Steve Cole, who's the PI from Ohio State. And this is not a therapeutic study. This was to develop ways to measure clinical outcomes in infants with SMA between ages of 0 and 6 months. And the reason for that was that at the time, these didn't really exist, and in order to really develop the therapeutics, you need to know how to measure the illness. And so he has a lot of different types of measurements. Some of them are motor function scales, and some are physiological measures. So these are more examples of the category of biomarkers and disease outcome measures. And also some molecular biomarkers, SMN. Messenger RNA levels and protein levels as well. And so this study is complete, and it's been a huge success and added a lot to the field. It came at the same time as the Spinraza approval, and actually the data set from this study was instrumental for helping that as another natural history comparison group. And the baseline paper is written, but the full data is coming out pretty soon. The second one, and this is more of an imaging-based study. So this does have a therapeutic drug, the Ulast, the same drug that's also in the ALS study that works on microglia, decreases neuroinflammation. But here, he's doing the study in primary progressive MS. And unlike MS, the field had not fully yet developed ways to measure this as well. So a big part of this study is developing those tools, largely imaging-based tools to measure the illness. So again, in that category of disease outcome biomarkers. So just for some of the examples, the main one is whole brain atrophy. The secondary ones are DTI, MTR, OCT, and then another way of cortical atrophy. And so this study will accomplish hopefully with many things. One is knowing if the therapeutic intervention is safe and whether it has an effect on these measures, but also developing really a large data set of information on the natural course of the illness and how these outcome measures compare to each other. So I think biomarkers are really critical to your study, really throughout the whole phase of development from preclinicals to your last study. There is an exciting field to be in, and I think that there's some unique challenges in CNS to develop these, that that are, I think, exciting. Imaging and the ways that develops fluid age markers. There's lots of different approaches, and I think one of the key things is when you talk about biomarkers is to try to be specific, you know, about what type of biomarker you're talking about. Because they're not all a good one, but they all can add important things to develop your project.
Results for each one at the end of the study, which is, if they're important endpoints, is worth doing, but if it's things that are really more exploratory, it's not necessarily worth it. It's going to add workload at the end. And so that's another thing to keep in mind in terms of doing it, but also the kind of, the litmus test we use on the calls is, if you can't tell me kind of how you're going to measure it or analyze it at the end, probably not a good choice as a secondary endpoint. It's really just exploratory. You don't really have any clear way of what you're going to do or what you're going to do. And, you know, a lot of times it's that dynamic we talked about this morning. I don't want to miss something, so I want to make sure I look at it. But you can look at it as whether you're relevant to be secondary. But the registration is an important thing to keep in mind, because that is a non-trivial amount of work that's really not fun in most things to the level.
Chris's comment about being careful when you list the secondary outcome measures.
you know, if it's something you really have no idea what you're going to do with it, but you just want to collect it just in case, then maybe you want to not like collect it at all. You have to think about, like, there's a cost of blood draws, there's a cost to, somebody has to do some clinical markers, there's a cost of multiplicity, which you'll hear a little bit about later, in terms of, you know, even if you look at all these things, are you going to, if you've collected so many things, are you going to trick yourself into doing the wrong follow-up study because, you know, you have 10 patients and, you know, 100 exploratory endpoints. So you do really need to think critically about what it is that you're trying to accomplish with that. That's not to say that there may not be some things, and then there's always the, just freeze a little blood and see us out. Maybe later somebody will come up with something to do with it, which is also potentially a possibility if you have a storage facility. But just, you know, there's a cost associated with those things. And trying to think, what is the value of that information going to be? If you don't have a good idea as to why you're collecting it, you may want to think about why you're collecting it at all. Now, there's some things that, if it's a drug study, like concomitant medications, you know, that's something that, even though you're not going to have any power to look at those things in your small studies, knowing what people are on in terms of continents is probably going to be necessary as you go through a more sort of formal drug approval process, but just things to consider.
Yeah, often, you know, in later phase studies, the phase three or a registration trial, you actually are required to kind of actually prioritize your secondaries. And you might take a statistical hit for that, which we can care about later. But it's still good to think about it in the early days. And one of the kind of tests of are you doing too much that we usually do is send the sheet that says all the activities to a few nurses and coordinators who will know the patients and know the physics. The honest truth that you're, if it's too much,
or patient advocates.
Yes.